U.S. government debt levels are more than 10 times annual tax receipts. There is apparently little concern in Washington, D.C. as the annual deficit, for a single year, mind you, was more than $3 trillion for the first time since the hit the panic button days of the Great Recession. Except that now huge deficits are coming during great economic times. Moreover, as the Congressional Budget Office has forecast, the debt load is expected to rise to 133% of GDP over the 20 years. That's higher than the U.S. debt-to-GDP ratio during World War II. But perhaps the most striking aspect of the growing debt is the fact there really is no end in sight, and the U.S. has no chance of ever paying off the debt. So what is the national debt as a percentage of the federal government's income? Income, in this case, is the federal government's tax revenue. And it turns out by this measure, we're in uncharted waters. In fact, the national debt is now 11 times annual federal revenue. And as far as I can tell, that's the highest it's ever been. In 1945, the national debt was $251 billion, and tax receipts were $45 billion, meaning the national debt was 5.6 times tax revenue that year. Specifically, in 2018, the national debt, $21.4 trillion, was 10.9 times the size of annual tax receipts, $1.9 trillion. That's even higher than what it was during the dark days of the stimulus following the Great Recession. In 1981, on the other hand, the total debt load was only 2.5 times annual tax receipts. Total U.S. debt, including all forms of government, state, local, financial and entitlement liabilities, comes close to 2,000% of GDP, according to A.B. Bernstein. The biggest potential load comes from entitlements, but is being pressured from rising levels of federal government debt as well. The warnings about potential debt hazards come as the total federal debt outstanding has surged to $22.5 trillion. A debt reform advocate says now is the time for the U.S. to tackle the issue before recession hits. Total potential debt for the U.S. by one all-encompassing measure is running close to 2,000% of GDP, according to an analysis that suggests danger but also cautions against reading too much into the level. Welcome back to the Atlantis Report. You are here for your daily dose of the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. Please take a second to hit the like button, hit the subscribe button, and don't forget to also hit the notification bell. Thank you. I predict you will see a massive inflation of prices in stocks, gold, and real estate, while everyday goods and tech will remain artificially cheap, at least relatively. Maybe over an infinite timeline, but certainly not instantly. First, it is not a closed system. Second, we're not exactly increasing total money supply, as I've realized in the last couple of months after reading three white papers on the topic. It's many times more complex, depending on how the printed money, really, created bank accounts, is used and its downward effect on the economy. That being said, if you pump money into a specific market, like corporate bonds, how does that, in turn, affect the overall money supply? The holders of those corporate bonds get, say, bailed out of their malinvestment. At a glance, someone would assume that since X has increased, all assets have increased. But have they? Say the ones that held the corporate bonds are corporations, and those corporations decide to buy back stock. Is that going to raise the price of milk? No, it's going to instead raise the price of that stock and lower liquidity of that particular index. So what one should take away is that printing money blows asset bubbles in specific markets, usually ones tied to the wealthiest individuals, who profit from it, such as real estate, stocks, and other investments. It doesn't necessarily equate to the price of the petrodollar across the world, which is by far the greatest factor in determining if inflation is going to hit all goods, or as mentioned above, price of everything. It is, therefore, imperative to realize that the U.S. will hit massive inflation more readily if the petrodollar dominance is quashed, and oil becomes more expensive to the U.S. The way an average individual should hedge against this bubble blowing is to buy any assets like land, gold, stocks, and simply hold them. But this is more to escape the increasing issues related to wage suppression, increased taxes, and other byproducts of a rotting empire guaranteeing profits, socializing its economy. In conclusion, I predict you will see a massive inflation of prices in stocks, gold, and real estate in the next decade, while everyday goods and tech will remain artificially cheap, at least relatively. And we have enough history to draw on in this era of QE to see this. Real inflation is growing but at a modest pace. In the 80s and 90s, besides a few years of large official inflation, it's been around 2-3%. Now it's around 6%. But look at the stock market PE ratios. Used to be 2-3x was high. Now that number is growing to 40-50x earnings. That's 3-4,000% over the same period. 2% compounded over a decade is a compounded interest of around 21%. 6% compounded over a decade is around 80%. So inflation of overall goods has in 20 years been an accrued 100%, double, whereas real estate is 5x that at 500%, and the stock market almost 50 times that at 4,000%. The Fed announced that they will keep the fractional flow reserve, FFR, between 0.00 and 0.25%, and that they will also increase their purchases of treasuries and mortgage-backed securities. The Fed puts an $18 trillion U.S. government bond market under lockdown. With bond yields at record lows, the dollar tumbling, and gold at record highs, one side of the market is screaming that the Fed is entirely out of control while stocks remain near record highs, increasingly echoing the early days of Venezuela's or Zimbabwe's epic stock rallies. The Fed is counterfeiting trillions of dollars. The government has created mass unemployment and is spending way beyond what it takes from us in taxes. While the livelihoods of the American citizens are destroyed, the government refuses to shrink. More promises that can't be kept are being made. The U.S. government creates money at will. No bonds, bills, taxes, or budgets needed. The entire house of cards that defines the U.S. economy rests on the foundation of the dollar's reserve currency status. Lose that, and the economy topples. In the face of record high employment years after the end of the Great Recession, the Fed's worship of Wall Street kept them engaging in massive borrowing and kept the system awash in artificially cheap money. Meanwhile, mom and pop retiree ate their seed corn because they could not earn interest on their money, as zombie companies were propped up. Now the Fed has no choice but to keep rates low but has no ammo to make a meaningful rate cut that would help us weather this storm. The Fed's action has destroyed price discovery, creative destruction, and free markets in general. With revenues massively down and stratospheric private and the public debt, we will have to raise taxes at the worst possible time. Oh well, at least we had that tax cut for the ridiculously rich, which did not trickle down. Extreme government debt is why the Fed, even before the pandemic, has worked hard to keep interest rates low, thus hurting savers who don't want to be in the stock market. If interest rates were back to historically normal 4-5% levels, that would add roughly $1 trillion more in government spending and borrowing every year. The government would have trouble due to the increased risk of default, paying back its loans, and/or getting its bonds sold, further raising the interest rates and debt needed to attract treasury bond buyers. That's how governments and economies eventually collapse, ruining everyone's finances and destroying millions of jobs. Spending has to decrease substantially to prevent this future outcome. Start by eliminating all 2,300 federal subsidies, deliberately hidden in many federal departmental budgets and not detailed in its own individual departmental budget as it should be, so that you and I cannot see this fiasco of unnecessary government spending, which is estimated to be about $1 trillion a year. This is how to reduce federal spending. Eliminate all 2,300 federal government subsidies, $1 trillion annual cost. Combine Medicare, Medicaid, and senior prescription drugs into one federal department. 535 congressmen and senators don't need their individual huge staffs to repeat the work of each member 535 times. They get small staffs and a small pool of workers for each political party to share their work results with all their party members. We sell the 14,000 government buildings not being used. We toughen Social Security disability requirements, especially for reasons of stress. Since Medicare fraud is estimated to range from 10-25%, or hundreds of billions of dollars per year, while private insurance fraud is less than 1%. Fire the government workers, and instead hire insurance companies as third-party providers to administer Medicare and Medicaid. Government agencies that are responsible for Social Security or any form of welfare subsidy must operate within administrative costs of no more than 5% of their total budget, same as a good charity. They only bailed the big business out. It looks like the swamp got him too. If economic recovery is what you want, you would put checks in the mailbox of Americans a step back and watch it move. The form follows function. They are killing the little guy and have no doubt if it's happening, it not an accident. Big business and government, they own it all. I don't trust the motives of the Federal Reserve. I don't believe they are there to help us. I believe they are there to help themselves and help their international banking masters take control of the whole financial system. But in order to do that, they must destroy the US dollar and force us all to accept their long-desired, one-world currency, owned and controlled by them. So are they there to help us, or pretending to help us with all this free money? With the true motives being to flood the world with US dollars, thus making them as valuable as toilet paper? I believe they are up to no good. Why else do they operate in absolute secrecy? No one thinks any government handout will not come with heavy penalties, do they? I'm expecting that the $1,200 per person, the extra $600 per week unemployment, etc. will be either counted against any refund due or will be added to 2020 income per the IRS. Same with those PPP loans. Some unexpected tax ramifications next year. Stocks markets always decline from bubble valuations. Every single time in history. The only time where the stock market goes up despite bubbles and valuations forever, is called hyperinflation, such as Venezuela, Zimbabwe. Bonds yields going down. Gold going up and outperforming stocks. But day traders are focused on overvalued stocks instead of undervalued gold mining stocks. This is a recipe for doom. Owning stocks that go down fundamentally in an economic depression versus owning assets that actually go up in a depression. It's unrealistic to think stocks should go up 100 to 500 points a day. Besides the higher it goes, the higher stock prices are, and you can't keep buying more and more of increasingly expensive stock. Gold is starting its engines and heading to record highs. Are the ideas of omnipotent government and central planning finally on their way out? To say things are messed up is an understatement. Most small businesses that make America great will get no help from Uncle Sam. As the economy looks at trying to reopen, Washington will turn its attention elsewhere. It will not be about state governments that are broke and helping the unemployed. Our economy is caught somewhere in the twilight zone, a place that exists for moments but where wrong decisions often lead to madness. The truth is we will not know where we are until we reach the other side. It is uncertain when that will be, but do not expect the economy to land on its feet. While it may not be as bad as many hyped-up doom porn forecasters predict, it will be painful. Both sides loot the taxpayers, and all their friends get money. Sadly, most don't get that. They think it's just the other side. Like there's more than one in Washington. I believe one morning, when I wake up and check the headlines, it will say that all of the banks worldwide have shut their doors. Not only will the banks have shut their doors, but the ATMs will not be working, and places of business will be closed because there is no way to conduct any monetary transactions. We came real close to that in 2008. What happens then? Think about it the next time you go on a long walk. What if there were no monetary transactions for even just 3 days, a week, a month? It could get desperate and violent. It could rock our world. I can understand the jackasses in DC stringing this along as humanly possible because this is going to be a real dumpster fire. I figured it out early in Obama's administration that there is only one destination for this train wreck. He didn't even start this mess. This was put in place long before he got into office. This was set into motion long before they had a chance to mess it up themselves. This was set into place by the powers that be. I believe those powers are corporations. This could be really, really ugly for millions and billions of people. Embrace that idea and go from there. I'm doing what I can and telling friends and family to prepare for hard times. Most don't believe it could, will happen. I can't make them take action. I can only do what I can do and help those close to me. Hopefully, I am wrong, and I am just a weirdo that has a bunch of canned food and ammo stocked up. In this republic of bananas, we will continue to print infinite amounts of money while denying that a trip to the emergency room already costs $10,000, a year in college $80,000, or that housing costs have risen well above wage increases for decades. We will make stocks go so high that there will be an even greater wealth disparity leading to even bigger riots in the streets. Because why raise taxes or cut spending when you can just print the money? And on Netflix, this fall, watch Dollar Conjurer starring Jerome Powell and a cast of PhDs. A show where everyone pats themselves on the back until in a surprise, no one saw coming, things go horribly wrong. RIP US dollar fiat, the true barbarous relic. The pandemic is not the problem. The Fed is the problem, a hideous and disgusting institution that must be eradicated. This was the Atlantis Report. Please like, share, leave me a comment, subscribe, and please take some time to subscribe to my backup channels. I do upload videos there too. You'll find the links in the description box. You will also find a PayPal link if you want to make a donation. Thank you wholeheartedly to all those of you who have already donated. Stay safe and healthy, friends.